Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rudolf Ohler to the stage.
So thank you for the nice introduction. So we heard several talks and presentations about different platforms to investigate and quantitate biomarkers, and also on their reliability, reproducibility. My presentation will focus more on the biological background, and I will show you one example in colorectal cancer. Where do these biomarkers come from, and why are they so interplaying with each other? May I have the first slide, please? So my work is focusing on the crosstalks between immune cells and cancer, and we are interested mainly in colorectal cancer. And to understand these crosstalks of the cancer with the immune cells in colorectal cancer, you have first to know a little bit the background of the normal immunology in the gut. So you see a cross-section of this colon. You see here the mucosa and the submucosa and the muscle layer. And the mucosa consists of this single epithelial cell layer. And underneath you find the lamina propria. In the lumen you have many myriads of different bacteria there. And so the immune system has to deal with it in the normal situation. And there are different mechanisms to impede the bacteria to go through this layer of epithelial cells. First of all, you have a mucus, which stops the bacteria. Then we have IgA reducing plasma cells, and epithelial cells themselves produce antimicrobial protein. And therefore, we have a huge number of immune cells here in the submucosa. They consist of lymphocytes, neutrophils, and macrophages. But how it is now in the tumor? Here you see a colon. This is the tumor. And this is a distant place of the mucosa, which we investigated and compared with each other. So this would be the normal situation, the tumor situation. The normal situation is, as I showed you before, the single layer epithelial cell. And in the tumor, we have something similar. So we have not a single layer of cells anymore. We have a multiple layer of immune cells, of tumor cells. But these tumor cells try to build a similar structure. And between these islets of tumor cells, we have a lot of immune cells. So the lamina propria and the normal mucosa corresponds to tumor stroma. Here you see the infiltrating immune cells, lymphocytes, macrophages, and neutrophils, and we quantitated them and could show that we have lymphocytes, or the overall lymphocyte count is more or less the same. The macrophages is decreased in comparison to the normal, and the neutrophils is strongly increased. Here is the summary of this data. The overall infiltration of with immune cells is decreased in the tumor in comparison to distant, and only the neutrophils increase in their number. So let's take a more closer look to the lymphocytes, because lymphocytes, there are different types of subtypes of lymphocytes. CD8 positive effector cells are reduced in the tumor, and we have an increase, a strong increase in CD4 positive regulatory T cells, which was also here shown in the FOXP3 positive staining. So regulatory T cells can inhibit these effector T cells. The effector T cells are those which are killing the tumor, which are producing TNF-alpha, which are producing interferon gamma. And the regulatory T cells produce a lot of factors to inhibit this response. They hydrolyze ATP to adenosine, they produce granzyme B, perforins, TGF-beta, IL-10, and IL-34. These are all potential biomarkers, which can be then detected using the platforms. Then we went further to look whether this increase of regulatory T cells leads to a decreased production of interferon gamma by the cytotoxic T cells. But now, therefore, we isolated the lymphocytes from the tumor of the patient. we isolated the lymphocytes from the normal tissue and cultured these cells and activated these cells and found surprisingly that in the tumor, that CD8 positive T cells in the tumor are more aggressive than those in the normal tissue. And this could be also be confirmed in the tissue where we stain for mRNA, for FOXP3, for the regulatory T cells, and interferon gamma. So it's not just an artificial system in culture plate, but also in the tissue itself. We have Treg and interferon gamma producing CD8 positive lymphocytes in the same tissue. This was surprising. It's not as expected. So this way, the lymphocytes, when we go on and look for the macrophages, macrophages are known to be very plastic. They can develop a phenotype, an M1 type phenotype and an M2 phenotype. The M2 phenotype is supposed to be anti-inflammatory and pro-immunogenic, pro-tumorigenic. And there are many studies showing in mice and in humans that M2 macrophages are increased in breast cancer, in lung cancer, and melanoma. And they play a role in the suppression of the immune system. The M1 macrophages is formed in response to interferon gamma. So we make a detailed analysis. First I want to stress that in the gut, the situation is a little bit more complicated than just M1 and M2. We have four different types of macrophages. And in addition, we have a different source of tissue-resident macrophages. They are constantly replaced by monocytes which migrate into the mucosa. Then they differentiate to MF1, then MF2, 3, and 4, and so on. The difference between these different types of macrophages is CD206 and HLA-DR expression. So here is a complicated slide, but I would like to focus your attention to this summary. This is the ratio between CD14 and CD206. CD14 is a M1 marker, CD206 is a M2 marker, and you see an increase of this ratio. So obviously, we have here an increase of M1 macrophages in the colorectal cancer when compared to the normal tissue of the same patient. So this means that we have here, a shift towards this earlier stage of this more inflammatory macrophages in the mucosa. Another mechanism to inhibit the immune response is the expression of PD-L1. There are a lot of this checkpoint molecule is not only expressed by macrophages, many tumors express PD-L1 in melanoma, in lung cancer, but not in colorectal cancer. And when you, as you can see here, we have here not only that the tumor not expressing PD-L1, also the macrophages. The macrophages here in the normal mucosa express PD-L1 at a high level, and here in the tumor, this PD-L1 expression is nearly gone. This also might be the reason why checkpoint inhibitors are not working in colorectal cancer. There's only a very small subgroup of patients, the MSI-positive patients, which profit from checkpoint inhibitors. But all other 85% of patients have no effect. So this now is a little bit of a summary. The colorectal cancer is increasing the number of regulatory T cells, is reducing the number of T effector cells, but those cells which survive this reduction, they produce more interferon gamma. The interferon gamma is modulating the macrophages towards a more inflammatory phenotype. To prove whether this is just true in these few patients, this were 20 patients, we defined a so-called FIM score. In this FIM score, we included FOXP3, interferon gamma, and CD14, CD206 ratio, and looked at it in the TCGA database to compare the expression of this biomarker, of these tissue biomarkers, to the prognosis of the patient. And you see here we have a hazard ratio of 1.3, statistically significant. So this means the more we have a change towards this FIM score, the higher, the worse is the prognosis of this patient. So now to the 4 minutes left, so I can go through the to the neutrophils. The neutrophils are those cells which increase very strongly. And this is very interesting because neutrophils are normally supposed to be the first line of defense of the innate immune systems against bacteria, but not against tumor. So in bacteria, against bacteria, they have the phagocytosis, degranulation, and netosis. But what happens in the tumor? So especially the group of Friedlander in Tel Aviv showed that there are different types of neutrophils. He did a lot of work in mice. That's the difference between bone marrow and circulation, but also the tumor-associated neutrophils differ to the neutrophils in the blood. But also within the tumor, we have a so-called N1 type and N2 type polarization of the neutrophils. The N2 type, similar as the M1-M2 dichotomy in macrophages, is more pro-tumorigenic, and the N1 type more tumorigenic. So we looked at the locations. Where are these CD66B positive neutrophils in the tumor? Are they everywhere? But now we have found always these clusters of neutrophils with a lot of neutrophils. When we looked very closely in the HE stain, we saw that there are many dead cells there. Then we stained with active caspase, antibodies against active caspase 3, apoptosis. And we found this is always a co-localization of the neutrophils with apoptotic cells. But what was also interesting, that we found no macrophage infiltration in these areas. So its tumor is normally assumed to be a cell which is very strong and strongly proliferating. But when you look at the actual images or the tissue sections in patients, you see always a lot of dead tumor cells because they are unstable, they have problems with the angiogenesis and so on. So they have always dead cells. And these obviously attract the neutrophils. And the response, the immunological response to this depends on the type of cell death. When you have a necrotic cell death, then you have, of course, a phagocytosis, and the system cries alarm. So we have a release of TNF-alpha, IL-1, IL-6, and pro-inflammatory cytokines. But if you have apoptosis, this phagocytes, in our case, neutrophils, take up these apoptotic cells and release anti-inflammatory cytokines like IL-10, TGF-beta, and prostaglandins. And this is not just an absence of alarm, it's really an active anti-inflammatory response. And on all our patients, when we found neutrophils, we found active caspase 3. And when we look at the literature, we found that the incidence of dead cell area in the tumor is associated with the poor prognosis. So now to sum up, in addition to the effect on the T-regs, on the effector T's and the macrophages, we have an increase in the neutrophils. And what we now want to do is to look whether we can translate this knowledge to biomarkers which we can measure in the liquid biopsy. That's why we want to use biomarkers which can describe the FOXP3 T-regs, TNF, interferon gamma is already soluble, and to look for markers for the M1 macrophages. So we analyze our patients. We have 63 patients in all, where we know all these data about the infiltrating macrophages and so on. And here you see an analysis where we analyze more than 90 different soluble immunomodulators. Here, this is a log scale. And unfortunately, all those biomarkers we would be interesting to look at because they are produced by regulatory T cells, they are so low concentrated in our patients. So with that, I want to say thank you to the people who did this work and to you for your attention.